Irrigating Service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, or good morning, but I guess it's after 12. So it's good afternoon, and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Jerry Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. And this is our first broadcast for the fall of 2015. So welcome to the show. If you haven't seen the show in previous years, this class is about plant materials. It's Gardens of California, but it really is kind of a science-based class on how to grow plants, the types of plants that do well in California, everything, the technical aspects of maintaining a landscape, how to prune trees, how to water landscapes, how to fertilize, the diseases and pests that we're getting. If you aren't familiar with me, I am a plant pathologist. My graduate degree is in plant pathology from the University of California, Riverside. My undergraduate degree is in botany from Cal Poly Pomona. And I currently work for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner's Office, where I run a plant diagnostic laboratory and diagnose plant damage and diseases that come into the lab from various sources. So that's what I do during the week. But on Sundays, I teach this class here at Cal State University, Dominguez Hills. So today we're going to talk about water and how to water your garden. Nothing could be more important topic right now. We're in the midst of a four-year drought. Everyone's hoping for rain this coming winter. There's a lot of talk about El Nino and a wet winter. We can all hope that it's a good rainy wet winter, but hopefully it all doesn't come in one day or a whole bottle of water come in one day, because that creates its own problems. So we're going to talk about how you water your garden, how water moves in the soil. I haven't talked about this a lot in the past, about the effect of soil and soil texture on the movement of water in the soil. And if you understand that, it'll help you understand how to water. And I see it all the time. One of the most common problems I see in garden maintenance is inappropriate watering. And if you don't water correctly, you're probably not going to be able to do anything else that helps your plant materials. If you're not watering right, everything's going to go wrong. Your trees are going to suffer. Your lawn's not going to do well. Your vegetables aren't going to do well. Your shrubs, everything. You got to water correctly. That's the first thing to do, is understand how to water. We also have a requirement for students enrolled in the program to attend an outside program or lecture and write an essay saying what they learned. And so at the beginning of every program, we like to have upcoming events that students can attend, and then they'll learn something about plant materials or landscapes or farming or anything to do with plants. So let's take a look at our upcoming events that you can put on your calendar, and then we'll move on to some of our disease or pest samples that I brought in today. Thursday, Garden Talk with Lily Singer at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. This is usually every Thursday, so the next one coming up, or maybe the beginning of the series. It's a series of lectures. September 17th, from 9:30 a.m. to 12 p.m. So Lily has been running this program for quite some time now at the LA County Arboretum. Lily is a very well-known horticulturalist in Southern California. She used to publish a horticultural magazine, and she's a well-known lecturer and consultant. And you can call the Arboretum at 626-821-3222 for more information. This is a paid class. You can attend individual classes, or you can attend the entire series. She gets in guest speakers and presents a lot of very good information on how to garden and what plants do well in Southern California, very similar perhaps to what I present here during this program. In addition to that, we have the organic fruit and vegetable gardening with Jill Morgananelli at the LA County Arboretum as well, September 12th, 2015, from 12 to 4. Again, this will be a paid class. and you can learn how to grow fruit trees and vegetables organically. So give them a call at 626-821-3222. In addition to that, we have the plant information with Frank McDonough. Frank previously hosted this program. He is a plant information specialist at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. His lecture will be September 2nd, which is this coming Thursday, 1:30 to 3. No, Tuesday's the 1st, Wednesday's the 2nd. So information, you can get more information on the SouthBayOrchidSociety.com website, or you can call the Arboretum. In addition to that, the Pasadena Garden Tour is coming up September 22nd from 8 to 12 p.m. For more information, check the sbchs.org website and go on the Pasadena Garden Tour and see what other people are doing in their gardens and get ideas for what you can do in your garden. So let's come back to me, and that's all our upcoming events, but we will have upcoming events at the beginning of every show. This is a live broadcast, and you can call in or email us questions. And if you have a problem in your garden, if you're interested in growing a particular plant material, give us a call at 1-800-339-1193. Any question, anything that you've got in mind, and we'll talk about it. If you've had a problem with a certain plant material, if you've had problems with your tomatoes, with your peppers, with your squash, your melons, lettuce, whatever it is, that's what this whole show is about. Give us a call. I'd love to get your calls. You can bring something new to the program in that we'll be able to discuss your problem, and other people are probably having a similar or the same problems. The textbook for the class is the Sunset Western Garden book right here. Now, this is a wonderful kind of book for almost any home gardener throughout the Western United States, not just California, but it really includes all of the Western United States. It's an encyclopedia of plants. So if you know the name of your plant, either the common name or the Latin name, you can look it up in the book and read more about it. You can read about citrus. You can read about roses. You can read about different vegetables, tomatoes and peppers and squash, all that kind of stuff, peas and beans, corn. They have excellent sections on just about every plant material you can think of in here. Plus, they have a very nice section at the beginning of the book on plant uses, plants for pool sides, plants for erosion control, plants to attract hummingbirds, plants to attract butterflies. So you can read sections on there where they give you a list of plants that serve specific purposes, screening plants if you want privacy, things like that. And at the back of the book, they have a large section on fertilization, pruning, propagation, pest control. So this is really the first book you should get if you want to purchase a book on home gardening for the Western United States. There's a nice section in here also on the plant zones or the climate zones that we have throughout the Western United States, which will help you understand what plants will do well in where you live and what plants you probably shouldn't try and grow because they're just going to do very poorly. You'll struggle with them all along, and eventually they just won't look very good, and you'll either pull them out or they'll die. So this is a Sunset Western Garden book. And now, of course, we're talking about water. We're talking about drought. And a lot of people are getting rid of their lawns, which use a tremendous amount of water. Nothing uses more water in a garden than a lawn. Lawns really are the guzzlers. Nothing can even compare to it. So there's this tremendous interest in what to replace my lawn with. Ground covers, shrubs, small trees, maybe large trees. You know, now you're going to re-landscape your yard, end up with a much more interesting garden because lawns are really boring. And I just want to show you a couple of books from my library that could maybe help you select plants to grow in your garden, especially if you're interested in California natives, which are always, you know, very good selection for growing in Southern California. Obviously, they are native here and they should do well, although there are challenges to growing California natives. This book here is Flowering Plants of the Santa Monica Mountains, Coastal and Chaparral Regions of Southern California. So you'll find a lot of stuff in here on a lot of the very popular materials that people are growing right now. Manzanita, ceanothus, things like that, in addition to a lot of other things. You can see the yucca here, yucca whipple, and I'm not sure what's on the very front, but there are some flowers that you can grow that are native to Southern California. A lot of really, really interesting stuff. Here is another one on Southern California, native shrubs of Southern California. This last one, let me just say, the author, of course, is by Nancy Dale, and it's published by the California Plant Native Plant Society. I believe it's probably that. I bought this at the Eaton Canyon Nature Center, where I used to be a docent. This is the flowering plants of the Santa Monica Mountains. This is by Peter Raven, Native Shrubs of Southern California, and University of California Press, Berkeley. So these are just a couple of examples. In addition to that, there are growing, this particular book, Growing California Native Plants by Marjorie Schmidt, University of California Press, Berkeley. And so this would be a really nice little book if you're interested in growing California natives. But you can also, of course, find a lot of information directly on the internet nowadays because, well, everything's on the internet. I like to have a mystery plant. So you can call in and take a guess what our mystery plant is. And this is it here. And if I swing it over here and it hits me in the face, nope, it didn't. This is our mystery plant. Now, it's got a little dieback. It's got a dead branch there and a dead branch here. I should prune those off. I haven't done it. But it's blooming, and so that's what I wanted to show you. If we can get a camera to zoom in on these flowers, and you can see. Now, this is not a particularly drought-tolerant plant. You're going to have to water it. If you had it in the ground, you'd have to water it probably every 2 weeks in the spring and the fall, maybe once a week in the summer, especially if you're in a hot inland valley. Along the coast, you could be a lot easier to grow it. But you can see how pretty the flowers are. I don't know if you can, but if you can recognize that flower, you'll guess the genus. So this is a tropical version of the genus, and we'll talk a little bit about them later. But this is our mystery plant today. I'm going to leave it here on the side, and then I'll talk a little bit more about it when people give us a guess as to what it is. There it is, right there. I better move that so it's not blocking me. Let's see if we can have it just there so you remember that we have a mystery plant. Give us a call if you think you know what the name of that plant is. Now, but before we move on to talk about water and how to water landscapes and all the different technical aspects of irrigating, let's take a look at a couple problems that you might have in your garden right now. Now, the first one is a virus. And if you go to the overhead, let's take a look at these tomatoes. And viruses, of course, are particles. You can debate whether they're alive or not alive, but they are predominantly moved by aphids from plant to plant. And this one here in my hand shows typical virus symptoms that you might see in the fruit on tomatoes. And this one as well. You can see all this mottling in the fruit. Typical symptoms you might see in the leaf are distortion of the leaf, curling, drooping, all sorts of problems. And this one here doesn't show any of the virus symptoms. This is off a separate plant. This plant was virused. This one's not. Now, what do you do about virused plants? Well, there's no treatment. Once your plant gets virused, it's virused. There's nothing you can do about it. You might choose to tear it out. It is an inoculum source to spread the virus to adjacent tomatoes. It would probably be picked up by an aphid and moved leave the healthy one right there. Other symptoms you might see on virused fruit, like bell peppers, would be a twisting and contortion of the fruit. You see that also on cucumbers. They'll be twisted and contorted. So those are typical symptoms of virus. And it's, you know, there just is no treatment for a virus plant. Once your plant is virused, it's virused. There are some interesting aspects of virused plants. If you can get a tomato up and covered with fruit, and then it gets virused, it's not all that important because you got your yield. You got a lot of fruit, it's an annual, you tear it out, and next year you start again. But if your plant gets virused when it's only a few inches tall, you're likely to end up with a stunted, distorted plant that doesn't grow very much and doesn't produce very much fruit or no fruit at all. If you're growing a pepper and you got a big pepper plant and it's covered with peppers and then it gets infected, not a big deal. If it gets infected when it's 2 or 3 inches tall, it's ruined the plant. So a lot of times when you're trying to avoid virusing, you want to get your plants in the ground before there's a lot of aphid activity because they're the major vector of viruses. Now, there are mechanically transmissible viruses that can be moved around on pruning shears or just by touching a virus plant with your hands. and then touching another plant, you can actually move tobacco mosaic virus, one of the more common viruses that you see in gardens and landscapes and farms. But most viruses are actually moved by aphids, and they can move them a variety of ways in terms of how long they keep them. Now, here's another problem. This is a pepper, and this pepper has, let's go to the overhead and take a look at this pepper here. And this happened just in the last couple days. You can see here this large lesion. This is actually sunburn. Of course, it was, this is from the Pasadena area, and it was very hot over the weekend, into the low hundreds, 101, 102. And the sun on a hot day in the afternoon comes in and hits this fruit, and it burns it. So this is sunburn, fairly typical. This is a purple variety of pepper. Let me just harvest the pepper itself off the foliage. It doesn't taste any different than bell peppers. And this one's purple from the very beginning. The other peppers, the other, regular bells will color up red or orange as they mature. They start out green. This one starts out purple from the very beginning. And now another thing that you'll see on peppers, especially if you're in the supermarket, is if the end, the bell, is distorted and twisted, that indicates a virus infection. But there's nothing wrong with eating this fruit here. The virus that's in this won't infect you or hurt you in any way. Those are viruses. Now let's take a look and move on to a different pest. This is Algerian ivy leaf that is covered with scale insects. Scale insects are, and I don't know which scale this is, there are many different species of scale insects. But one way you can recognize scale is, first off, they're little bumps that are easily scraped off with your finger. If you just scrape at it like this, it comes right off. It may leave a yellow spot underneath where it was feeding. And these may actually be mostly dead. And if you look on the backside, it's got the scale all over it too. Now, the Algerian ivy grows into my garden from my neighbor's garden, and it's always covered with this scale. I don't know the host range for the scale. I don't know what other plants it might attack. Insects always have a host range. They don't attack every plant on earth. It may be limited to similar species to ivy. It may just get on the ivies. But I just wanted to show you this because it's one of the easiest things for me to find in my garden in terms of a pest. Now this here, these are squash. This is the yellow crookneck squash. And if you've ever grown squash before, you've seen this. This is powdery mildew. Powdery mildew is extremely common on a wide variety of plant materials. It's common on roses, on squash, on grape, on a variety of trees. Sycamore trees get it. Crepe myrtle trees get it. And the thing is that the fungus that's on here will only infect squash. Each powdery mildew fungus is specific to it, the host. They're called, host specific, rather than having a broad host range. Like a pathogen that would have a broad host range would be something like a tobacco mosaic virus. It can infect thousands of different kinds of plants. Powdery mildews, this one only infects squash. And here it is on here. You can see it just starting up. Now there's a variety of ways to control this, and you need to get on it fairly quickly because it spreads fairly easily. And it can do a lot of damage if you don't control it. You can use milk and water at about a 50-50 mix, down to as little as 10% milk. You can use any milk product. You can use powdered milk. You can use non-fat milk, 1%, 2%, whole milk. It doesn't matter. It is actually the protein in the milk that probably is effective. It actually coats the leaf. Then you get bacteria and fungi growing in that layer, and those bacteria and fungi suppress the powdery mildew. You can also use neem oil or stylet oil. Both of those are effective at suppressing powdery mildew. And there are some potassium bicarbonate-based organically registered fungicides. There's one from Kellogg. I don't know if other manufacturers are selling that. But potassium bicarbonate is very effective at suppressing powdery mildews. So whether it's on your roses or on your vegetables, those are how you can control it. You want to get on it right away. right when you see it start, you want to get at it, because this white fluffy stuff you see on the leaf are long chains of microscopic spores that are called conidia. And those spores can be blown around in the wind or splashed, especially if with overhead irrigation. The water hits the leaf, it splashes the spore onto another leaf, it starts an infection on that leaf, and then it's spreading onto within that plant, or it'll spread to adjacent plants. So control your powdery mildew, get on it quickly. Don't wait until it's done its damage, because then it's too late. So that's powdery mildew. Now this pepper, which was the purple pepper, I don't think there's a lot of problems with the foliage. Unfortunately, I broke off a big section of it when I was trying to pick that fruit. Now this last piece is from a bush bean. Let's take a look at this. And this is typical mite damage that you'll see. You see this speckling in here. And I didn't get a chance to put it under a microscope to see how many mites are on here, but it looks like there's quite a bit of mite activity on the back of the leaf. Yeah, I know you probably can't see it on your screen, but yellow speckling on the leaf. If you look very carefully, these are little tiny yellow dots, and they get more and more of them to the point that the whole leaf gets yellow or white even. And that's typical of mite damage. It also could be ozone damage, but I'm pretty sure that this is mite damage. So, you know, in beans, this is bush bean, which is a summer vegetable. You know, one of my favorite things to grow in my vegetable garden are bush beans. You get a lot of string beans on a small plant, so I kind of like that. But this is typical if you don't spray for it. And you can control mites generally with oils and soaps, and also you could select a miticide. But oils and soaps should be pretty good. Now the caveat on oils is always you cannot use any oil product when it's over 90 degrees outside. You should never use oil on hot days. It's best to use in the spring months or you know during a cool period in the summer months. So today is not a day to use oil. Of course, today is it's the end of August. The summer's coming to an end in a few weeks. And we're going to, today's August 30th, isn't it? So it's way too hot. If you're up in the 90s and you spray with an oil, you'll burn the foliage. Growers are reluctant to use oils too many times during the growing season because it does affect growth and yield a little bit. If you use it a lot, they'll notice it in their yield. For a home grower, don't worry about that at all. But that's a mite damage due to spider mites. And usually you get a lot of webbing. If you want to recognize spider mites, you get this fine webbing on the backs of the leaves. It can actually, on a tomato, it can cover the whole plant, and you get these little red dots everywhere. And that's the actual mite, because they're red. But they're tiny, tiny little dots. And mites are not insects. They are arachnids. They're related to spiders and ticks, because they have eight legs. And they make webbing. They make a web. So that's how you can recognize spider mite. But you got to get on that right away too. If you let that go, especially on your tomatoes, you're going to get a lot of damage. So let's move on now and talk a little bit about water and how to water. I want to talk about some of the very basic concepts of irrigation for landscapes and farms. One is how do you measure the water you apply to a landscape or a garden? The answer is in inches, just the way you measure rainfall. So you either apply an inch, you apply a half an inch, you apply 3 inches. That's usually how you think of how you're applying water to the landscape. So you apply it by the inch. The next thing is your application rate. How many inches per hour are you applying? If we take a lawn, for instance, many of the typical lawn sprinkler systems that have pop-up spray heads will apply anywhere from an inch and a half an hour to up to 2 inches per hour. That's a very, very high application rate. It's actually way too high because soils will typically only absorb water at about a half an inch an hour or less. I don't think you ever really get above an absorption rate of more than a half an inch an hour. So typically a lawn sprinkler system will start to experience runoff off the surface of the soil within about 4 minutes of runtime. So now we know how to measure it. We know the concept of application rate in inches per hour. The next question that everyone asks is, how often should I water my plants? And how long should I run my sprinklers? Those are important questions. How often and how long? Well, let's take a step back and before we answer those two questions and ask, what's our goal? When we are watering a landscape, when we're watering plant materials in the ground or even in a pot, what's the goal? The goal is to wet the root zone, the entire root zone, not just a little part of it. So different plants are rooted to a different depth, and therefore they have to be watered at a different frequency. Shallow rooted plants dry out rapidly. So plants that are only rooted to 6 to 12 inches are going to dry out far faster than a plant, specifically shrubs and trees, that are rooted to 2 to 3 feet or even 4 or 5 feet. 80% of your roots on a tree are going to be in the top 2 to 3 feet. But so when you're watering a lawn, you're watering to soak the soil to a depth of 6 to 12 inches. When you're watering a tree or a shrub, you're going to want to soak the soil to a depth of 2 to 3 feet. So obviously it's going to take a lot more water to get a tree wet than it takes to get a lawn wet in terms of how many inches you apply. But what happens to the lawn is that upper 6 inches dries out rapidly, especially in the summer heat. So within 48 hours of watering a lawn, it's going to be dry and you're going to have to water it again, or it's going to wilt, because lawns are not drought tolerant. Some lawns are more drought tolerant than others and could probably be watered twice a week, even in the heat of the summer. But cool season grasses are not going to tolerate going dry for more than 2 or 3 days at the most. So you give it a good watering, you soak to a depth of 6 to 12 inches. So how many inches does it take to get a soak, to 12 inches? How many inches does that take? Well, it takes approximately an inch of water. But what really influences that is your soil. What kind of soil you've got. Do you have a clay soil? Do you have a sandy soil? Do you have a loam soil? And what do those terms actually mean? When you say you have a clay soil, what do you mean? When you have a loam, what does that mean? Well, these are texture classes. It is the texture of the soil. And let's go to the overhead and I'll show you what we call the soil texture triangle. And if we go to this overhead, and you'll see that the soil, let's just briefly talk about what the soil is to begin with. The soil is composed of mineral particles, and they are defined by size. You can have clay particles, you can have silt particles, and you can have sand particles. And you can have percentages. So you could have 100% sand, you could have 100% clay, you could have 100% silt. When the influence of the three particle sizes is equal, you have a loam. That doesn't mean equal proportions. It means equal influence, because clay particles have a disproportionate influence on the soil texture. So if you have a 30% clay right here, and 70% silt, you would have a clay loam. But say you had 30, 30, 30, and you came together here, and you'd probably have a sandy clay. But so you can have a sandy clay, you can have a silty clay, you can have a sandy loam, a silt loam, but loam is your best soil. And let's talk about what that really means, because this is your soil triangle and how you can figure out if you've got a clay soil or a sandy soil. So that was that part of it. And then we'll talk about some other aspects. Let's come back to me. So let's go back to what the soil really is. The soil is those mineral parts with the clay, the silt, and the sand. Plus then you're going to have things bigger than the sand. You're going to have rocks, different sizes of rocks. And then you've got the living part of the soil. That's, mites and insects and worms and all sorts of things that are living in the soil, roots. And then you've got air. About half the soil can be made up of just air. There are pores in the soil, air pores. And they can be big pores, and those are called macropores. And there can be little pores called micropores. And the proportion of those is directly influenced by your soil texture. If you have a clay soil, you're going to have mostly micropores, very, very small pores that hold onto the water very tightly. If you have a sandy soil, you're going to have almost all macropores that don't hold onto the water very well at all. It drains rapidly and it does not retain water well. Sandy soils drain well, but do not retain water. Clay soils do not drain well, but retain water for a long time. If you have a loam, which is the equal influence of all three particle sizes, you have a mixture, kind of a balance between macropores and micropores. That's why loams are your best soil for growing plants. It's hard to grow plants in sand. It's hard to grow plants in clay, but it's fairly, well, it's a lot easier to grow plants in a loam. So, you know, somebody says, I have a loam, you know, what does they mean? They mean they have a soil that's equally influenced by sand, silt, and clay, and they have an equal balance between the pore sizes. They've got big pores, medium pores, and little tiny pores. What happens is the big pores drain to the little pores. Remember that. The big pores cannot hold on to the water. They're too big. The little pores, by capillary action, hold on to that water very tightly. And so when you water the soil, it drains from the big pores to the little pores. The little pores hold on to the water longer. What's the vent? Well, those big pores are also full of air, and roots need air. So you want an oxygenated soil. If you flood your soil and leave it flooded for any period of time, it will become anaerobic. You will run out of oxygen very quickly, and that's very bad for plants. Anaerobic soils are very, very bad for plants, and it will kill the plants. It'll poison them because the roots need oxygen. If they don't have oxygen, you're going to have a lot of problems. So that's the concept of what soils are, and to take a little closer look at what soils are, let's go to well, before we go to that, let's just keep talking a little bit about water. And let's talk about the next concept in water, which is evapotranspiration. We talked about how you water the landscapes by the inch and how you measure your application in inches per hour. But there's also the concept of how much water you lose on a daily, weekly, monthly basis from the soil. There's two ways of water leaving the soil. It can evaporate from the surface of the soil, or it can go through the plant, absorbed by the roots, taken up through the shoots, and out the leaves. Plants have water-conducting tissue called xylem. It is basically a straw. Think of it as a tiny microscopic, or not even microscopic, but a tiny, tiny straw. And it is full water. It's filled with water at the tip of the root, and it has water in it all the way up through the stems and out to the leaf. And that stream of water is continuous with no bubbles in it. And the roots absorb the water, and the evaporation out of the leaf draws the water up and moves water from the roots up into the shoots. The plant spends no energy moving water around. It is it's strictly by evaporation. There's pores on the backs of the leaves, and they open up and they let the water leave the leaf, and that draws water up from the roots. When it's hot out, you lose more water. Your ET rates go up. It's measured in inches. How many inches a day do you lose? How many inches a week do you lose? So just the way we measure the application of water to the field or your garden in inches, we measure how much you lose in inches. So how many inches do we lose in Southern California on a daily, weekly, monthly basis? Well, historically, we know fairly well how much we lose. It depends on where you are. If you're at the beach, you lose less. If you're in a hot inland valley, you lose more. If you're out in the desert, you lose the most. So let's take a look at this overhead. And I'll tell you, let's just start with the hot inland valleys. A lot of us live in the hot inland valleys. A lot of us live at the beach, too. But if you're in the San Gabriel Valley or the San Fernando Valley, you will lose approximately 1 inch a week in the spring and the fall, and up to 2 inches a week in the summer. Now that is your ET rate. It is based, actually, is what we call a reference ET rate, and that's what this chart shows you right here. It shows you two locations, Riverside and San Antonio, San Antonio, Texas. It says ETO curves in Riverside, California and San Antonio, Texas. Starting in the first month, they're losing just under, well, this isn't labeled very well, but they're losing about point, this must be daily evapotranspiration rates, because it says about 0.07 here. And in the middle, it's going to get up to losing here a quarter inch a day. So this is daily. They're losing a quarter inch a day. So you can see in 4 days, you lose an inch. And in a week, you're going to lose about 2 inches. So this is July, August, September, October, November, December. December, you get down to losing less than 0.1 inches per week. So in 7 days, you might lose about 0.7 inches. So this just shows you, as you warm up into the summer months, you lose more water. As you go back into the fall, you're losing less, and you get into the winter and you're losing the least. So that's for Riverside and San Antonio. These are hot, hot spots that lose a lot of water. So that's your ET rate. We know that historically you lose about an inch a week in the spring and the fall, and about 2 inches a week in the summer in Southern California. Now at the beach, it's a little less than that. It's actually 3/4 of an inch a week in the spring and the fall, and about 1.5 inches a week in the summer. And out in the desert, it's higher. So you quickly get up to about 1.5 to 2 inches a week, even in the spring. At the peak of the summer, you're losing 3 inches a week. In the winter, we all lose, whether at the beach, in the valleys, or out in the desert, we all are losing about 1/2 inch a week. Now, there's a caveat to that. That's how much water a 4-inch tall stand of a cool season grass would use if it had ample water and was not restricted at all in water availability. So it's a reference ET rate. The actual ET rate will vary depending on the plants you're growing. So the ET rate I'm talking about is the reference ET rate for a cool season grass that's 4 inches tall in an open field and had unlimited water supply. How much water would it use? So, but how much does a different kind of plant material need, like a cactus or a tree? That's pretty well known as well. That is called the crop coefficient. The crop coefficient is a percentage of ET that a particular species needs, a percentage of the reference ET. So most cactus have a crop coefficient of about 10%. Where a lawn might need about 1 inch a week in the spring and the fall, a cactus would need about 1/10 of an inch a week. Now, a cactus doesn't need it every week because it can go months without water and it'll be fine. So that doesn't talk to frequency. Frequency is a different aspect, but the crop coefficient is a percentage of ET that a particular species need. The crop coefficient for citrus is 66%. The crop coefficient for something like an olive tree would probably be about 20 or 25%. It's even, you know, it's extremely drought tolerant. So the lower that percentage is for a particular species, the lower the crop coefficient percentage is, the more drought tolerant it is. So now our tall fescues, things like Marathon and Medallion, are the typical lawns, the more popular lawns that people are growing throughout Southern California, actually will do fine at 80% of the reference ET rate. So what does a tall fescue need in Pasadena? It needs about 0.8 inches per week in the spring and the fall, and about 1.6 inches per week in the summer. Now, how often should you apply that? Roughly in the spring and the fall, you're going to water your lawns twice a week and apply approximately 1/2 inch. If it needs 0.8 and you give it 1 inch, you've given it just a little bit too much, but that's, you know, of course in a drought year, you don't want to do that, but you're in the ballpark. You know, you're not watering. A lot of people call me up, they're watering every day for 10 minutes. They've got a 70 minutes total runtime for the whole week. Now, maybe people aren't doing that right now because of the drought, and they've been told that they are not allowed to water more than twice a week, but people used to call me up all the time and their sprinklers were going every day for 10 minutes. when they should have had a 30-minute runtime for the whole week in March, April, May, and June, they were running 70 minutes. They were applying twice as much water as the lawn actually needed by watering way too frequently. The other thing that I see is people will water very briefly. They'll have a 3 or 4 minute runtime, and that will barely water the soil. And in 3 or 4 minutes, you're only going to water about an inch of soil or a half an inch of soil. And that's mostly just going to evaporate, and the plant, especially if you're watering a tree or shrub, it's not going to see it at all. It's just going to evaporate. If you water the soil, and say you get 3 inches of soil wet, in this type of hot weather where we're up in the 90s, close to 100 degrees in the inland valleys, in a day or two, that top inches will just be dry. It's going to evaporate and take off. So that's why lawns have to be watered fairly frequently and shallow. So you're applying about a half an inch to an inch of water in the spring and the fall, and then in the summer you're going to be applying probably every other day, 3 times a week. This is what the lawn needs, not what the requirements are from your local water district in this drought season or drought emergency or crisis, because they're restricting you to watering twice a week. But what your lawn would like, if it's getting full sun all day long, you're in the San Gabriel Valley, it should probably get about a half an inch 3 times a week. That would be optimum for maintaining the lawn. Now, if they tell you you can only apply it twice a week, then I would give it about 3/4 of an inch twice a week. And then you'd be getting your inch and a half, and hopefully you're going to get a deep enough soak and it's not too hot and your lawn will do okay. But if you add that all up for a lawn, you'll see that a lawn uses anywhere from 36 inches to 48 inches of water per year, up to 4 feet of water per year to keep a lawn alive in a hot inland valley in Southern California. If you're at the beach, you're probably gonna need about 36 inches because you're gonna not need to apply quite as much water. You know, at the beach, you could probably water, once a week in the spring and the fall, and twice a week in the summer. But every time you water, you give it about a half an inch. So, you know, if you think about it, 80% of 3/4, inch and a half. Yeah, you just uses less water if you're right along the beach. If you're out in the desert and you're trying to keep a lawn alive and you're growing on sand, you probably will be watering every day because that sand doesn't retain the water. It dries out extremely fast and it's extremely hot. So that's where, you're really using a lot of water, keeping lawns alive out in the desert. So let me see what these notes are about here. We talked about total water loss from the soil, a reference evaporation rate, crop coefficient. You can also develop a landscape coefficient. And you can look at when you have a landscape, how do you water a mixed landscape of different plants? Well, this goes back to planting too a little bit, because you don't want to mix plants that need very little water to no water with plants that have to be watered 2 or 3 times a week. So you shouldn't be growing high water use plants next to something like a cactus. You shouldn't have cactus and rose bushes in the same bed because the cactus can be watered about once a month and given about a half an inch to an inch of water once a month. And the roses are gonna need to be watered at least once a week and maybe twice a week in the heat of August and September. Roses don't use nearly as much water as a lawn does, but they are fairly moderate in their water needs compared to a lawn, but use a lot more water than a cactus. So when you group your plants, when you plan your garden, you put plants of the same water needs together so that when you water them, you're watering them all for their needs and not soaking the cactus so that you can keep the rose bush alive. So how can you figure out how many inches per hour your sprinklers apply? You can take cups and put them out on the lawn, coffee cups, any straight-sided cup, and run the system for about 15 minutes. Run it for exactly 15 minutes, I should say. Then go measure the depth in all the cups. If you do this on your lawn, you'll learn two things. You'll learn your application rate in inches per hour. What you do is say you put out 5 cups. You measure the depth in all the cups. You add them all up. Then you divide by 5, and then you multiply times 4, and that gives you inches per hour. So if you measure the depth in all the cups and they're all roughly a half an inch, you add it up, divide by 5, you have a half an inch times 4 is 2 inches per hour. The other thing you'll learn is whether you have even distribution, because when you put out the cups, say one cup has a half an inch and another cup has an eighth of an inch. That means that your sprinklers are not giving you even distribution on your lawn. That's important for lawns, because if you have a dry spot in your lawn, the lawn will die there and you'll get a dead spot. It's not that important for shrubs. Shrubs do not need absolutely even distribution underneath them. If you've got fairly, you know, you can have one side of the shrub get soaked and the plant's going to take up that water and it'll be fine. But lawns are, you know, in a lawn, you've got thousands of individual plants. When you're watering a shrub, it's one plant or maybe a handful of shrubs in a bed. And if you can get the bed wet, then you'll be fine. You can have dry spots in a bed and it won't hurt your shrubs. Now, I have a video talking about this, how to measure your application rate, how to check your sprinkler system to make sure you're not wasting water. Let's take a look at this first video. It's actually from the City of Pasadena Water Department, and they'll talk a little bit about it and show you how to measure your application rate in inches per hour. Let's go to our first video.
Hello, I'm Lawrence Budd. I'm an irrigation specialist with the Pasadena Water and Power Conservation Program. Welcome to our video on how to tune up your sprinkler system and measure your outdoor water use. I will guide you through how to measure your water use, show you where you might need improvements, and some better ways to water your lawn and garden. The first thing we're going to do is check for leaks around the house. A leaking toilet or sprinkler valve can waste hundreds of gallons of water every day. So first, check around the house and be sure all the water is shut off. A good way to see if you have any leaks is to simply look at your water meter. See the small black triangle in the middle? It turns for every tenth of a gallon. If it starts and stops, that's good. If it slowly creeps along all the time, that's bad. It means you might have a constant leak somewhere. When was the last time you watched your system run? Heads tend to get blocked, clogged, and broken. So first, let's walk around and see how this system's doing. I see a couple of things in this lawn right away. This brown spot is not caused by a lack of watering, but instead the head is plugged. Here's another one where the head is turned. It's keeping the sidewalk nice and clean, but missing the lawn. And here's one that is completely blocked by plants, preventing the water from reaching the lawn. Now you can buy extensions to raise these heads up, or you can simply cut back the plants, clearing the path for water to reach its intended area. The last most common problem is that the sprinkler head has the wrong nozzle, causing the water to shoot way over its intended area. So the first thing we did was to watch our system run. Then we straightened, unplugged, and unblocked any heads that are giving us problems. Now we're ready to measure the system's efficiency. To do this test, we're going to need 6 cans or cups, all the same size. I'm going to use these small plastic cups. We also need a ruler and a pencil. As you can see, I'm setting up the cups out in the middle of the lawn, in the main watering zone. Try to set them within one zone if you can, and not too close to the heads. Now I'm going to turn the zone on for 10 minutes. We'll see a lot of things happening as it runs. First, the cups are obviously catching water, but some other things are happening as well. Do you see the mist in the air? This tells us that the water pressure is too high and should be turned down. And over here, the zone has only been on for a minute or so, and already we have water running off the lawn. It's sad to know that landscape runoff is the largest single cause of water waste in Southern California. After running the zone for 10 minutes, gather up the cups and lay them out so we can measure the amount of water in each one. Take a ruler and stick it in each cup. We can see that 2 of them have about a third of an inch, 2 have about half an inch, and 2 have almost none. We're not done yet. Write down the amount of water in each cup. The 2 almost empty ones tells me that this area is not getting enough water, and that means low uniformity. You end up overwatering the entire area just to get these areas wet enough. The right thing to do is to correct the nozzle size or unplug the head so these areas get wet faster. Now we're going to combine all of the cups into one. Grab your ruler again and measure the depth of the water. This is how much water we are applying each hour. In this case, it is roughly 2 inches per hour. That's a lot. Is that good? Well, no, but it's very common. Your soil absorbs water at about 0.2 to 0.6 inches per hour, a whole lot less than the 2 inches per hour we're watering at. So what happens when you water this fast? That's right, you get water runoff. There are guides available to help you set your controller for the correct amount of water based on the kinds of sprinkler heads you have. For more information, please visit our website.
So that shows you. Now, I like to use straight-sided cups. Those cups are just a little bit bigger than the base. So if you use a straight-sided cup, I think it'll be a little more accurate, like a coffee cup or a tuna can. But that's what you learn when you put out the cups. You learn your application rate in inches per hour, and that 2 inches an hour is extremely common. And then you also will learn whether you have uniform distribution. Now, think about that. If you apply, I mentioned it before, if you're applying an inch a week in the spring and the fall and about an inch and a half a week in the summer, and then you might continue to water in the winter about a half an inch. I don't know if I said that, but our ET rates in the winter are uniform. All the way from the beach out to the desert, you lose about a half an inch a week. That's how much water a tall fescue or a cool season grass that's 4 inches tall would use if it had adequate water. So you do need to continue. Now in the winter, you could probably water your lawn once a week for a total 15-minute runtime. There are, of course, newer, better sprinkler heads for watering lawns. And they are low flow heads that only apply at about a half an inch an hour, which would mean to get your half an inch to soak the soil to a depth of about 6 inches or maybe a little deeper, depending on whether you have a clay or a sand, then you'd have to run it for a whole hour to get that half an inch. Right now, you can run it for about 15 minutes to get a half an inch. The problem is if you run it in 15 minutes, in about 4 minutes, it starts to run off because the soil just can't absorb it at that rate. A lot of this should be ringing a bell that you should get rid of your lawn because they just guzzle water. They use so much water. If you re-landscape even the plants that are not necessarily highly drought tolerant, if you use shrubs and trees and a drought tolerant ground cover, you can dramatically reduce the amount of water you use to keep your landscape, and you'll end up with actually a more interesting landscape because you can grow some unique and interesting shrubs. You don't have to grow lawns. Lawns are a simplistic way to landscape your garden. You mow it once a week. Plus, do you really want to go out every week and run your mower and your edger and clean the walks and when you could have something far more interesting? And we're going to be talking about that a lot over the next 14 weeks. We're going to talk about the different plant materials you can use to replace your lawn. And we're going to show you some of them today, as a matter of fact. Now let's talk a little bit more about soil and what soil is and soil texture. Because that's really important. You know, what he was talking about was, you know, the mechanics of sprinkler systems and how you measure the application rate and the problems with runoff and the problem with sprinklers facing the wrong way. Do you really need an automated system if you don't have a lawn? My answer is no. If you don't have a lawn, you don't have to water so frequently that you need an automated sprinkler system. Automated sprinkler systems are really good for lawns because it's hard for most of us to remember, I have to water Monday and Thursday in the spring. I have to water Monday, Wednesday, Friday in the summer. I'm going to water for, you know, 15 minutes, give it a half an inch. If you don't have an automated system, then you forget about it. If you go on to take a trip, a vacation, you're gone for 2 weeks or 3 weeks, somebody's got to come in and water for you because those lawns need to be watered frequently. And most of us travel in the summer months, or at least when you have to water more frequently. So that's when an automated system is really critical for lawns. But if you have a drought-tolerant landscape, you're going to be watering it once a month in the spring and the fall and about every 2 weeks in the summer, if you water it all in the summer, but you know, maybe at the most every 2 weeks in the summer. And that means you can leave for a week or two and no one has to show up and water your landscape because it can go for 2 weeks without water. So now I have another video, and this is how water moves through soil. And I've kind of mentioned already how it moves. It moves two ways, by gravitational forces and by a capillary force. So let's go to this first section. This is just going to be a 5-minute clip from this 30-minute video that talks about how water moves through the soil. So let's go to our first section from this video and talk about how water moves through the soil. Let's go to that video now.
Apply to all soils. There are thousands of combinations of soil characteristics in the world. Mineral soil particles are a combination of sand, silt, and clay-sized soil particles, as well as organic matter. Sand particles are the largest, while clay particles are very small and highly reactive. Silt particles are intermediate in size and reactivity.
Two primary forces govern water movement through soils, gravitational forces and capillary forces. Pore size refers to the space between soil particles.
Soil pore size is a significant factor in how water moves through soil. Here, the space between the glass plates represents spaces between different size soil particles. The glass plates are further apart on the left side and closer together on the right side. The closer the plates are together, the higher the water rises. This rise is not due to pressure squeezing the water upward, but solely because capillary forces cause the water to rise higher when the distance between the plates is narrower. The same phenomenon occurs in soils. At the bottom of the soil columns near the water source, water rises more rapidly in the sandy soil because the capillary conductivity of the larger pores is greater. The clay soil has small pores and attracts water more strongly than the sandy soil with large pores, but transmits it more slowly. When the soils are wet, water moves through the larger pores between the sand particles faster than it moves through the smaller pores between the clay particles. However, water eventually rises higher in the clay soil because the pores are smaller and closer together. The rise is due to the forces of adhesion and cohesion. This is called capillary rise. Both the rate of water movement and the amount of water retention are related to pore sizes in a soil.
The USDA system of soil classification uses 12 different textural classes. This presentation will use three general categories of sand, silt, and clay.
Sand, silt, and clay-sized particles are rarely found in nature by themselves, so soils in this video contain some sand, silt, and clay. Just as soil types vary in texture and structure, they also vary in their ability to conduct and hold water. Using the model of the three general soil types, we see that soil water moving by gravity flows through open pores between soil particles. The size of the pores varies with the soil texture and structure. In general, water moves through large pores, such as in sandy soils, more quickly than through smaller pores, such as in silty soils, or through the much smaller, flat-shaped pores found in clay soils. In clay soils, very little gravitational or free water moves through pore spaces due to the small size and shape of the pores. This model represents water movement under ponded conditions into a land surface depression, such as an irrigation furrow or an open drain. When the water is first applied to dry soil, it moves outward almost as far as it moves downward. However, as the soil becomes saturated, gravity becomes the dominant force moving water downward. Water is nearly always moving in soils, either as a liquid or a vapor, and water can move in any direction. It moves downward after rain or irrigation, upward to evaporate from the soil surface, or up through plant roots and leaves and eventually into the atmosphere through transpiration. Water can also move horizontally through soil, such as when it encounters a restrictive layer of compacted soil or bedrock that impedes its downward movement. There are frequent attempts to prevent water movement through soils, such as when liners are used below sanitary landfills to prevent the movement of leachate water into underlying groundwater. Two forces primarily affect water movement through soils: gravity and capillary action. Capillary action refers to the attraction of water into soil pores, an attraction which makes water move in soil. Capillary action involves two types of attraction: adhesion and cohesion. Adhesion is the attraction of water to solid surfaces. Cohesion is the attraction of water to itself. Some surfaces appear to repel rather than attract water. This occurs when the cohesive force of the water is much stronger than the attractive force of the solid. For this reason, water drops form on leaves with a waxy surface. A similar phenomenon is frequently observed.
So that was a good demonstration of some of the basic principles of how water moves in soil. It really moves from the large pores to the small pores. The large pores drain and the small pores retain the water. So it takes less water to soak sandy soil to the same depth as it would take to soak a clay soil to the same depth. So when you're trying to water a large tree and you want to soak the soil to a depth of 2 feet or 3 feet, and we talk about applying 3 to 4 inches. Well, if you were in a sandy soil, 3 inches would probably get you down to about 2 to 3 feet. If you're in a clay, you're going to need 4 inches. And the goal is to soak or wet the root zone. So clay soils require a little more water when you water them, but they're going to retain the water longer and you water less frequently. That sandy soil is going to need to be watered again before the clay soil. So if you have a heavy soil, you water less frequently. If you have a well-drained or a sandy soil, you water more frequently. So now it's 12 o'clock with the top of the hour here, or maybe it's 1 o'clock. Let's go to a station identification. I think my clock is wrong. But let's go to a station identification and remind you that we are broadcasting from California State University at Dominguez Hills, which is a wonderful university and a wonderful campus. Let's go to our station identification.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Of your life today. look at you, I look at the future doctors, the future astronauts, the future math and science teachers. This is where STEM happens. This is where STEM comes alive.
My name is Zanaya Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. Did you know that in the first three quarters of this year, there were nearly 34,000 permitted production days of filmed content shot on location by crews just like this all around Los Angeles? While the production crew behind me is following safety protocols, that's not always the case. And the further a crew goes outside the 30-mile zone, the greater chance someone will get hurt. CSU Dominguez Hills has the only OSHA Training Institute Education Center in the LA Basin. We offer a certificate program designed for the specific needs of the film and television industry. Make sure your next production is safe. For more information, visit our website, csudh.edu/OSHA. That's csudh.edu/OSHA.
Teatro Dominguez is a multicultural theater company here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folktale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as entertainment, doing theater to help make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. So for instance, Teatro would do a play reading of a play about assimilating into American culture if you're an Asian immigrant. And that may be performed in a middle school or here on campus. I've had a number of teachers ask Teatro Dominguez to come into their classrooms to read scenes. We have workshops where we would bring a group like Culture Clash in or Cornerstone Theater Company to help our students learn about community-based theater creation. And the touring show is always interesting. Every year we take folktale or we create a folktale of our own, which is animals talking in masks, and we tour it to local second grade classrooms. So what Teatro does is really educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues, and it has more of a direct purpose for society.
Tune in to DHTV on Tuesday night for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
Hi, my name is Obi Wogboy, and I'm currently a junior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. The reason I came to this school was for the great environment, the small class sizes, and the amazing sociology program.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Hello, my name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
My My name is Kira Mathis. I'm an education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
Watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Gardens of California. My name is Jerry Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. This is the live garden show and broadcast where you can call in with questions about your garden or your landscape. If you've got a problem, our number is 1-800-339-1193. You can also email us questions, and if you have photographs of your garden, you can attach those to your emails. We'll bring it up, take a look at your garden, and talk about your problem. And in a moment, we'll put that email address up on the screen as well. So today we're talking, there it is, askdhtvlive@gmail.com. So give us email me a question, attach a picture of your garden. If you don't get a chance to do it today, well, we're going to be back next Sunday. We're going to be here for 14 weeks. The only weekend we're not broadcasting is Thanksgiving weekend, and there are 14 classes. So call in, ask us a question. You got a dead tree, you got a problem with your vegetables, you got a problem with your lawn. This is probably one of the easiest places you can get answers, and hopefully you'll get a correct answer. So we've been talking about how to water. We were talking about evapotranspiration rates. We know it's an inch a week in the spring and the fall, and 2 inches a week in the summer in the hot inland valleys, a little less at the beach, a little more in the desert. We talked about how water moves in the soil. And that's really critical to understanding how to water your landscape. Because if you do very brief, shallow irrigations, you're just gonna water an inch or two of soil. It's not gonna get down deep. It's not getting down to 2 or 3 feet. The upper 6 to 12 inches of your soil dries out rapidly in the summer heat. But if you get water down to 2 feet, if you get water down to 3 feet, that's going to be available to your trees and shrubs for 2 to 4 weeks. And of course, some plants are incredibly drought tolerant, can go weeks or months without irrigation, and they won't change a bit. And other plants will wilt within days. As soon as they go dry, they wilt. And that's basically like lawns, grasses. Once that 6 inches is dry, that upper 6 to 12 inches dries out, your lawn is gonna wilt. If you don't re-wet it, it's going to continue to deteriorate, and then the grass plants will start to die. So let's take a look at a couple plants real quick. This one is called Gasteria. This, I'm not sure where it's native to, probably Africa, but I'm not sure. And if we, let's go to the overhead, and I just wanna take a look at this little plant here. This is, like I said, this is called Gasteria. That's the genus. Someone just gave it to me this week, and I'm not sure of the species name, the full species name. So this is Gasteria, and it's extremely drought tolerant. It's a succulent. It's got thick, fleshy leaves that retain water in the leaves. And it's got a very thick epidermis, very waxy and hard, that resists desiccation. So this is extremely drought tolerant. You could water something like this once a month, and that would be fully adequate. Maybe every 2 weeks in the summer, that would be pretty good. Now, before we go to our first caller, I want to show you this plant here. Let's come back to me. We don't need to. This is a coleus. I grew this from a cutting. I like to propagate plants. Now this has big, soft leaves, and as soon as this pot goes dry, the whole plant will wilt. So this plant is not drought tolerant. It will not tolerate dry conditions for a prolonged period of time. It wilts, and if you don't water it after it wilts, it'll eventually just die. Now I love coleus. They're a lot of fun to grow, and I grow them from cuttings, or I'll grow them from seed. And I grow them in pots, and then I use extra water, especially lately, with the drought. I don't, you know, if you put them in the ground, it'd probably last longer. But so you can recognize a drought tolerant plant. It's going to be either succulent with thick, fleshy leaves, or it may have very small leaves that point up. It may have hairs on it. Our native plants, you'll see a lot of aspects of our native plants that allow them to go for extended periods without irrigation. They don't wilt when the soil dries, and that allows you to extend the period between irrigations and then save a lot of water. So, and I'll talk about that more in a second, but I see we have a caller. Let's go to our first caller. Oop, let me move this. Chris, calling from El Segundo. You're on the air.
Hi, this is Chris from El Segundo.
How can I help you?
Chris, calling from El Segundo. You're on the air. Hi, I have a problem. I'm on the second story condo. I need to turn the tone.
Yeah, turn the sound down on your TV.
Okay. I'm in containers because I'm in the second story condo, and I'm having difficulty growing the appropriate plant material because they struggle. They're right in line with the ocean. There's nothing between me and the ocean. And I tried junipers. I mixed my own potting soil. Is there a juniper that might work? There are 5-gallon pots, and I'd kind of like something that's in proportion to the height. Would a pygmy palm tree work? A lantana isn't going to get high enough, or ice plant isn't going to be high enough in a container.
So is this on a balcony? I'm not sure where you're growing these plants. Are you growing these plants on a balcony or inside your condominium?
I'm not sure where you're growing these plants. Are you growing these plants on a balcony?
Yes, in a balcony. They get 6 hours of indirect sun and 6 hours of bright sun from the west.
Okay. Well, that's a lot of sun. That's pretty good. And you're growing junipers right now and they're not doing well? You need to turn down the sound on your TV.
Right now,
well. No, I've given up until I started watching your program.
Well,
how do I do that?
Generally speaking, when you're trying to grow something on a balcony, you're better off growing foliage plants rather than plants that produce a lot of flowers or produce fruit. A lot of people have been interested over the years in growing vegetables on their balconies, and that's tough to do. You don't get a lot of production or very good yield. But if you're growing foliage plants that you're not necessarily growing them for the flowers, they'll do much better. But you want something tall enough to kind of screen that sun from coming into the apartment? Is that the goal? Chris?
No, I'd like it to be in proportion. In other words, if it's a 5-gallon pot. Yes, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. Go ahead. So what height are you shooting
like
for? 4 feet, 5 feet?
I'd like a certain, like a height, like maybe.
I'm not sure.
Maybe 2.5.
Oh, 2.5 feet. And you get that much sun. Well, sometimes I have to think for a minute about different types of plants.
Yes, it faces west.
And it faces west, and you get 6 hours of sunlight in the afternoon. That's quite a bit of sun. That's pretty good. I'm trying to think what might do well there. You're right. Maybe a pygmy date palm, which is Phoenix robellini, would do pretty well. And in a 5-gallon pot, they would be about 3 to 4 feet in height, and they don't grow very fast. How, your junipers didn't do well. What happened to them? Did your junipers die or do poorly?
They struggle. They get, I think it was aphids.
Oh, well, you know, any plant material you grow, you're gonna need to make sure you control any pests.
It's the salt wind.
That's true. There, you know, there's a lot of issues with salt spray when you're really close to the beach, and some plants won't tolerate that at all. So you have to be really careful with that. But I'm thinking, you know, the pygmy date palm you mentioned. I'm thinking of some other things that are, you know, you might try. I'm trying to think of the name now. It's Chinese lantern. The abutilon. Are you familiar with abutilon?
Lantana?
No, abutilon. It's called Chinese lantern. It comes in a variety of different. There are some that have to be.
Okay.
There are some that have to be supported on a trellis. And some that are upright and will tolerate and can support themselves. But it's called a abutilon. That might be nice. Another one is called Mahonia. Mahonia might do quite well. Mahonia is also known as Oregon grape. How often do you water them?
Mahonia is also known as Oregon grape. How often do you water them?
I've been watering about twice a week. Maybe that's part of the problem.
Well, when you water them, do you water them until it runs out the bottom of the pot?
Yes, just until then.
Yeah, you want to, because every time you water them, you want to water them until it, you know, really comes out the bottom of the pot. It really flows out of the pot. You might want to, I don't know how, it may be difficult to take them down outside to do that. But you'd need something that'll catch the runoff if you don't have that already. But you do want a deep soak. You might try, you know, a abutilon might be a nice.
Another problem.
And then in addition to a abutilon, you might try what I said, Mahonia. I'm trying to think, because you need something that'll tolerate that full sun in the afternoon. That's pretty hot. Even though you're right there at the beach, that full sun would be hard on a lot of other, you know, shade materials. So you might even be able to get away with a rose. There's some roses that'll actually. If you want to try and grow a rose, I would use a white colored rose, maybe an iceberg. And you really need to turn the sound down on your TV. So that you can listen to me talk to you rather than listen to TV.
Another problem I have, another question, is when they come in containers, they're in garden dirt. And so how do I accommodate them in the potting soil in the pot? And turning the volume down doesn't seem to help.
Okay, well, you know, generally when plants are propagated and grown in nursery production, they use a potting mix that's really excellent drainage. Anytime you're going to grow plants in pots, you want to purchase potting soil to use in your pots. You don't want to use cheap bagged material that's meant to be mixed with the soil. There's planter mixes that you can buy in bags. There's a wide variety of bagged materials you can get at nurseries and garden centers. And what you want to use is a high quality potting mix, and that should be fine. If the bigger the pot you can grow, the better. So if you can, you know, if you're buying them in fives, see if you can move them up to sevens or tens, 7-gallon or a 10-gallon. If you've got the space, you could even use a tub, and you'll probably be a little more successful. You do want to fertilize periodically, 2 or 3 times a year, depending on what you're growing. And give it a, and when you do water it, really soak it. And then if your junipers, now junipers really are full sun material. I'm surprised they didn't do well, because generally if 6 hours of full sun should be sufficient, even, you know, for junipers. But take a look at abutilon and Oregon grape. They might do quite well, and they get to about 3 to 4 feet in height, and then you can easily maintain them at that height with pruning. Okay? Well, thank you, Chris.
So you don't recommend soaking it in B1?
B1? No, B1 is snake oil. It's worthless. It doesn't do anything. It's just something to sell gardeners. So it's absolutely worthless product. I would never recommend. And you want to fertilize, and
well,
water is
your
strongest.
I'm hoping you'll rebroadcast this so I can hear the answer.
So no, B1 is really has absolutely
okay,
no beneficial effects.
I might have to hang up so I can hear the answer. Maybe you'll rebroadcast this in the future.
It's archived on YouTube, and you can watch this on YouTube quite easily. Just go into YouTube and put in Gardens of California and look for today's episode or class. We have another caller. So thank you for calling in, Chris. And let's go to our next caller.
Bye.
Goodbye. Who do we have calling
Hello?
Now? Gordon from Los Angeles. You're on the air.
Hello?
Hello. How can I help you? Are you there, Gordon? Is there, Gordon, are you there? Have we lost Gordon? Let's go to Terry from Pasadena. Go ahead,
Hi.
Terry.
I had a question about native plants.
Okay, go ahead. Are you there, Terry? Looks like we're having some technical issues with our call-ins. So, if we dropped you, please call us back. Are you there, Terry? Okay, well, do we have any other calls? Okay, that was unfortunate. Let's move on with our lecture and talk more about plants. And if we dropped your call, please call us back. And let's just talk briefly on the issue of growing plants on balconies. Generally, as I said before, they don't get quite enough of sun to grow plants to produce flowers and fruit. But if you're getting 6 hours of sun, direct sun, that's enough to grow white flowered roses. They'll do okay. Generally, you need about 8 hours or 10 hours of light to grow roses, or 12 would even be better, full sun all day long. But I see that we have another caller. Let's see if we can get this call to work. Who's calling now? Terry from Pasadena. Hopefully we won't drop you again. Terry, are you there? Gordon, are you on the line? Well, we are having problems with our phones today. Well, so do we have Gordon on the line? Well, our phones don't seem to be working right. Terry, are you on the phone? Hello? Okay. Let's go back to our lecture. Sometimes we have problems with our technical issues, and I guess we're having problems today with our phones. So, Gordon, if you're out there, maybe you could email us a question to askdhtv@gmail.com, or let's see if we'll get a phone call to go all the way through. But let's go on to talking about water and how it moves in the soil and how you water your landscape. So I've got another clip from the how water moves through soil. Let's go to the next section, which on this, let's go to this video clip, and hopefully the control room will figure out what's wrong with our phones today. But let's go to our next section of the video clip on how water moves, our 9-minute to 13-minute clip. And when we come back, hopefully we can answer some questions from the public who call in.
Resin films coat the surface soil particles, and rainfall runs off rather than infiltrating the soil. The other force governing water movement through soils is gravity. Gravity pulls water downward. Capillary forces can move water in any direction. The force of gravity is most evident in saturated soils. Once water enters the soil, the principles of water movement by capillary action and gravity hold true, no matter what the source of the water. Water can also move upward through soil or other materials by capillary action, as Dr. Watson explains.
This is an example of capillary forces at work, pulling water from the water surface up into the dry soil into the seedbed.
Capillary action can move water through porous materials other than soil. When the soil around a structure made of brick, limestone, or sandstone is wetted, water moves up through the stone material. When the water evaporates, it often leaves salt or other chemicals behind, showing how high the water rose. The same principles of water movement apply to landscape areas where water is delivered through an underground irrigation system. When the soil below the turf grass becomes saturated, capillary action draws water upward to the roots, nurturing the lawn.
Whether land is being used for agriculture, urban landscape, recreation, building sites, or landfills, it's important to understand how water moves through and is held by soils. Capillary forces, whether cohesion or adhesion, are largely controlled by soil texture.
Any factor that affects soil pore size and shape will influence capillary water retention and movement. Examples of such factors other than texture are organic matter, soil structure, and soil density. Elevation above a free water table also affects the water retained by a soil at a given elevation. Together, these factors affect the water holding capacity of a soil, as well as the rate of water movement. The portion of soil water available to plants is often referred to as available soil water. In this demonstration, equal amounts of water are applied to three soils with different textures. Sandy soils have less pore volume than silt or clay soils. Note that the water penetrates more rapidly and more deeply in the sandy soil than in either the silt or clay soils. This is because sandy soils have larger pores that absorb water faster and hold less water per unit of depth. Consequently, sandy soils require more frequent but lighter water application to maintain adequate water for plant growth and minimize losses below the root zone. Soils with more clay hold more water within the normal plant root zone. Thus, plants grown in soils with more clay can do well with less frequent and heavier applications of water. This is not to say that over-irrigation is not possible in clay soils. A frequent consequence of over-irrigation in such soils is oxygen depletion in the root zone, which limits plant root development. Whether soils are sand or clay in texture, it is important to time irrigations to replace the soil water extracted by the plant roots.
Welcome back. So that, you know, talked about water holding capacity in the soil, and that's really important. When you irrigate a soil, and it gets fully soaked, and then and it drains for maybe 30 minutes to an hour. The soil is said to be at field capacity. That means it's holding all the water it can hold. You want to get to field capacity every time you irrigate the soil, and you want the field capacity to be 2 to 3 feet deep. So field capacity means it's fully wet. Now it's going to take time for that water to either evaporate from the surface of the soil or be taken up by the roots and lost through the leaves. You can reduce your water use by about 30% on a lot of different plant materials by putting a thick layer of compost on the surface of the soil, about 3 to 4 inches of mulch or bark or whatever type of material you want to use. And it will dramatically reduce evaporation from the surface of the soil. That allows you to extend the period between irrigations Instead of watering every 2 weeks, you might be able to water every 3 weeks. And that's going to reduce your water use by about 30%, or even 50%, depends on how you look at it. So particularly like in tomato, if you mulch the surface of your tomatoes heavily, you can reduce the total amount of water you need to irrigate the tomatoes by about 30%. That's pretty significant savings. It also dramatically improves your soil. How can you improve a clay soil? Clay soils are one of the most difficult soils to work. Once they go dry, they become extremely hard, almost like concrete. Once they're wet, they stay wet. They're heavy and thick. So should you add sand? Well, generally, I don't know that that's going to help a whole lot. What really helps is organic matter, increasing the organic content of your soil. So if you've done vegetable gardening, if you're a vegetable gardener and you've used raised beds, that is one of the great ways to improve your drainage. Put down 4 inches of compost, turn it into a depth of 4 inches of soil, so you end up with an 8-inch mixture of 50% compost and 50% soil. You will then have a very light soil that has good drainage, but good water holding capacity. And you don't have to water it frequently. If you're growing in sand, a very sandy soil, you're gonna have to water frequently because it's gonna drain and dry out rapidly. So we've really talked a lot about water, and I wanna move on a little bit now and talk about winter gardening, and because that's kind of timely right now. The summer is coming to an end, even though it's hotter than heck today, and it's gonna stay hot probably through October. But the planting date for your winter garden is really September 15th. That's the earliest you should start planting winter garden materials in Southern California. And what type of materials am I talking about? Well, the lettuce in general does really well in the winter in Southern California. In the summer, it tends to bolt. You can grow leaf lettuce year round. But if you want to grow a head lettuce or anything that heads, so iceberg lettuce, or if you want to grow cabbage, or you want to grow cauliflower or broccoli, those are winter crops. Peas are a winter crop. And there's a lot of different kinds of peas you can grow. Peas are real fun. Now, if you're going to grow regular edible peas like the sugar snap, things like that, then you're going to want you're going to have to support them with a trellis. And but you want to get your peas in late summer or early fall. So starting September 15th, if you're going to grow pea and you want to grow snap peas, which are just wonderful to grow and really delicious, then you're going to want to get them in by September, around September 5th, 15th, I should say. And if not, you know, of course you don't have to do it exactly that day, but really in the last 2 weeks of September or through October, the later you wait, the cooler the soil becomes. What happens is the soil cools off over time. And right now the soil is quite warm and we have long days, warm days. You put your seed in, it comes up, we've got the warm, and you get a good rapid new growth for the young plant. By the time we get into November or December and it's getting cold, your plant will be up a little bit, and then it's big enough that it'll continue to grow and do well. If you plant when the soil has cooled off and it's gotten cold in December, it's going to be much slower to germinate and it's going to grow much slower. So you get a head start on your winter materials by planting them in late summer or early fall. Now we have another phone call. Hopefully we'll be able to take this call without any problems. Who do we have? We have Gordon from Los Angeles. Go ahead. You there, Gordon?
It doesn't work.
Hi, how can I help you?
Yes.
What's your question today? Gordon?
Oh, it seems to be a delay. It seems to be a delay response from your end.
You need to turn your TV volume down and only talk to me on the phone. Because there is a delay on the TV, but not in your phone. So turn the volume on your television down to zero and talk to me on the phone.
I'm ready.
Okay. So what's your question
today,
Greg?
I planted long beans again in an area, and I added compost. And did not put any nitrogen into the compost like you suggested. It was too late. I had already planted the beans. They came up. The ones on the right side of the planting started, didn't really take off too well. And as the season went on, it started to get yellow. And as it grew, it got more yellow and it went up the vine. The ones on the right-hand side were perfectly fine. As the beans started to come out, I noticed there was a silver tip on the top of the bean. And so I finally took a leaf to the nursery, told them what was happening, and when I told them there was a little silvery thing on the bean, they said it was spider mites. And yeah. They recommended an organic spray, seeing how they were vegetables. Didn't do it. That's besides the point. What I want to know is, do you think it was spider mites?
It's possible, yes.
How was that caused, and how do I get rid of them? Do you think it would be safe to replant them in the spring or in the spring again? Or
sure, let's talk about spider mites.
You might have from your experience.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about spider mites. That silvery cast is a very common symptom you'll see from mite infestation. It can, you know, I usually on the leaf, you'll see a lot of yellow speckling because the mites, of course, are quite small. And wherever they're feeding, they leave a little tiny yellow dot, but it's really tiny. So when you get a lot of mites, you get this yellow speckling on the leaf. If they're feeding on the fruit itself, it can be silvery. So it's possible, you know, without having it in hand to confirm the diagnosis, it is very possible that they are correct. Generally, you can use soaps and oils to control mites, or you could use a miticide. Soaps and oils are, of course, non-toxic to mammals and generally organically registered. Especially if you buy them in a, you know, if you go buy like Safer insecticidal soap or any of the soap products, they are considered organic. And you need to spray fairly frequently. You're going to have to spray about every 5 days to 7 days, at least for 3 or 4 weeks. So at least once a week for 3 weeks would be a minimum treatment. And you want to get on it early before the damage is done. Once you get that silvery appearance on an individual string bean, it's not going to go back. It's not going to be cured and suddenly develop the right color. So it's like permanent damage. I've had a lot of mite damage on my bush beans this year. You could also use oil products to control mites, but only when it's below 90 degrees. So most of these are best applied in the spring, especially the oil products. You want to use them in the spring. You might also, I'm not sure about organically registered miticides, but there may be something out there. I'm not sure whether pyrethrins, which are generally organically registered, are effective against mites. Because mites are not insects. They are arachnids. They are related to spiders and ticks. Excuse me. So you want to frequently check the backs of the leaves on your beans and look for any fine webbing. In fact, what I have here right here, and I showed it earlier in the program, these are bush beans. And you can see the yellowing on the foliage. And you may not see it real clearly on your TV screen, but it's actually little tiny yellow dots. And when they get a lot of them, it becomes large yellow spots. But this is spider mite damage on my bush bean. I haven't noticed that the beans themselves have silvered, but silvering is a common symptom from mite feeding on a variety of plant materials. So I would start, you could use Dawn or any dishwashing detergent. Dawn is a common brand. There's generic dishwashing detergents that you can get at any supermarket. I've used them as anywhere from a teaspoon to a gallon up to a tablespoon to a gallon. On thick or waxy leaves, I think a tablespoon to a gallon should not be a problem. I've used that on my citrus to control things like mealybugs and aphids and whitefly. Not so effective on scale, of course. Scales are very hard to control with soaps and oils. But yeah, I would use soaps and oils, and if you combine them together, then they're more effective. How do you spray your plants? Do you have a pump sprayer or do you use a hose end sprayer? Is Gordon gone? So, anyway, Gordon.
I didn't use anything. I just went ahead and pulled the plants up.
Oh, you pulled them out. But they sold you a product at the nursery?
Now, will these mites come back later on?
Well, you're going to replant in the spring, right? Because it's kind of late to plant beans. You're talking about next season?
Right.
Yes, mites are going to be a problem every year. So yes. You've got to scout it, and as soon as you see them starting, you've got to start spraying. And if you wait, the damage, it'll be too late. If you wait until you have a heavy infestation, the damage is done.
Okay.
But yeah, mites come every year. And spider mites are my biggest problem on my tomatoes and my beans in my garden.
I hope you get your phone system corrected for next week.
So do I. And I apologize for, there seems to be a delay problem here, so I don't know what it is. But
it's very difficult.
Yes, it's a little frustrating, isn't it? So I apologize for that. I'm not sure, we've never had this problem in previous years, but we'll take a look at it. We do have a new system in the control room for this starting right now. So, mites are a common problem on vegetables and on a lot of plant materials. There's a specific mite to camellias. There's a citrus bud mite that causes a lot of problems on citrus. There's a citrus rust mite that's a problem on the rind on lemons. It causes them to be silvery and hard. On oranges, they get these orange or rust-like streaks. And generally, you probably need to do a preventative spray early on because you can almost guarantee they're coming. But scouting, we're going to talk about IPM a little more in a later class. But integrated pest management, one of the key elements to that is scouting and making sure that you get early detection. Because there are some pests that every year they're really going to do the same thing. They're going to start off with small numbers, and they may be hard to see if you're not carefully looking for them. And then by the time you see them, there's lots of them and they've done their damage. And that is very typical on tomato with red spider mite. And I think I've got the exact same mite on my beans. Some mites, of course, will have a broad host range and will get on a lot of different plants. Other mites are very specific, only get on one crop, like the citrus bud mite. It really predominantly is on lemon. Maybe it goes to the other citrus, but that's what I always see it on. And the end of your lemon will have these funny finger-like growths. That's the citrus bud mite. The citrus rust mite gets on lemons and rasps at the rind and damages it, and it becomes silvery and hard, and then the fruit dries out. And then some of the other mites can be very specific, but the spider mites tend to have a broad host range, get a lot of different plants. And oils and soaps are very effective, but they are contact materials. You've got to get the spray on the backs of the leaves where the mites are feeding. If you just spray the tops of the plant briefly, it's not going to give you good control. You've got to get it underneath the leaf and really get it to run off. And then you're going to have to repeat the spray in 5 to 7 days. And you're going to have to do that fairly consistently for at least 3-4 weeks. And then they'll be cleaned up. They like to feed on soft new growth. They're not going to like the old established leaves, but beans, of course, are going to be growing new growth pretty much consistently throughout the season. especially pole beans that get real tall. So now the other problem I've had with my pole beans has been viruses. But typically with the viruses, you might get a mosaic pattern in the leaf, or you'll get distortion and twisting. If you get a virus, a pole bean, you might as well pull it out and just get rid of it, because there's not much you can do and you're not likely to get much of a yield from it at that point. And of course it is an inoculum reservoir to spread the virus to adjacent plants, and it's almost certainly going to be moved by aphids. So you need to scout your beans early in the season and scout them a couple times a week. Turn over the leaves, look on the back, get a hand loop or a magnifying glass and take a good close look at it and look for any mites. As soon as you see mites, and almost guaranteed you'll start seeing mites within a month or two of them coming up, maybe just in weeks, you'll get your first mites. So probably preventative sprays early on when the plants are small, and then careful monitoring and repeat the sprays. And again, oils and soaps should be pretty good. And you can get organically registered products directly from your garden centers or nurseries, or you can just use dishwashing soap. And then the oils now, you've got Volk oil, Sunspray Ultrafine oil, neem oil, stylet oil, which you usually have to find on the internet, but they have got mint oil and they've got clove oil. And so a lot of oil products are on the market. They're all non-toxic to mammals, usually considered organic. But the only caveat is you cannot use oils when it's over 90 degrees. So mostly in the spring and early summer. Now July was pretty cool this year, but now we're really too hot for oils at this point in time. So yeah, it's very possible that they were correct in their identification. If you get it again next year, you can send it into our laboratory at the LA County Agricultural Commissioner's Office, and we'll take a look at it and confirm that diagnosis. It's hard to confirm a diagnosis without the sample in hand. Photographs can be very helpful, but there's still the question of whether you really know what's going on without an actual sample in hand to put under a microscope, see the mites, and know. So we have, a question here from Andy. It says, since moving into this property, I've been gardening, and my carrots, sweet corn, and lettuce would challenge anyone's. Well, great. I love to hear when people tell me they're doing great, because most people just call me and tell me their plants are dying. 3 years ago, I started buying my pecan tree leaves in the fall, burying my tree leaves in the fall when the trees shed, and since then, the only thing that grows is tomatoes. My carrots now are only as big around as a pencil after 4 months. My romaine lettuce never go to head before they bolt. Romaine doesn't head. My sweet corn, which was 6 to 7 feet tall with 3 to 4 ears to now only 2 to 3 feet tall with little to no ears. I thought at first it was the chlorine and fluoride the state puts in our drinking water. No, it's not. So I purchased a filtering system that was supposed to filter out these two items, but still no help. So I started going over the changes made to the garden in pecan leaves. It's the only thing I have changed in the last 20 years. So there is something in the pecan leaves that keeps other plants from growing. I don't think that's your problem. If you're growing these materials in the same spot year after year, I suspect what you need to do is rotate. You need, if you grew corn for several years in the same spot, you need to grow something else there and grow your corn somewhere else. You need to rotate. You didn't mention whether you have or not. So if you have been rotating, well, then that's not your problem. But the first thing to do is to rotate. Grow your tomatoes where you grew your corn last year. So next spring, where you grew your corn, you're going to grow tomatoes. Where you grew your tomatoes, you're going to grow corns or beans. The reason is that over time, you're going to develop root pathogens or organisms in the soil that are bad for that particular crop. Usually, they're fairly host specific, and they will only affect that crop. And so you want to go to a really different crop. So if you're growing tomatoes, you want to, in this spot in your garden this year, next year, you're going to grow something that's not in the nightshade family. So no peppers, that's nightshade. No, eggplant, potato, tomato. Those are all Solanaceae, or the nightshade family. So you're going to want to grow something maybe from the pea family, like beans, or a grain, like corn, or maybe squash from the cucurbits. And so, the first thing I do is rotate. The other thing I would do is during the winter months, I would do what they call green manure, or it's an organic way to fumigate your soil. You can grow cabbage and it will head up. You mentioned that your romaine is not heading up. Well, romaine really doesn't head up anyway. But if it bolted and started to flower, that's very typical of lettuce in the summer. That's one of the drawbacks about lettuce in the summer is it flowers rapidly. It'll flower and bolt because we have long days, and that signals the plant to flower. And once it flowers, then the leaves become quite bitter. And some people like that. I'm not a big fan of that. So you get better lettuce in the winter months. And if you're going to grow anything that heads, you really have to grow it in the winter months, or it will bolt and you won't get a head. So head lettuce, like iceberg lettuce or cabbage, you grow that in the winter. Broccoli, cauliflower, Brussels sprouts, some other winter materials you could grow, spinach, cilantro does really well in the winter. If you try and grow cilantro in the summer, it's just going to produce the mature foliage, which looks a lot different than the immature foliage, and then it's going to flower, and you're going to get very little of what we call cilantro. Cilantro is mostly a winter crop, and spinach is a winter crop too. So I don't think the pecan leaves are really a problem, but I wouldn't directly bury them in the soil. I would pile them up and make a mulch pile and compost them before I mix them into the soil. You could also go get some compost and mix that into the soil, because adding organic matter will really help your soil tremendously. We didn't have a chance really to talk much about the pea family, but if we could just maybe scroll through some of the sweet pea flower pictures that we have, just to show our viewers the sweet peas. Sweet pea, of course, are not edible peas, but are grown for their flowers. If you get them in the last week or two of September, you'll be able to cut sweet pea flowers and bring them in by Christmas as a cut flower inside your home. They're incredibly fragrant and they're really pretty. Maybe we could bring up a couple sweet pea flowers behind me and you can see how pretty they are. Peas are a cool season crop. In the rest of the United States, they're growing them in the spring. Here in Southern California, or in California in general, well, maybe up in Northern California where it's colder, you would grow them in the spring. You need a trellis. You can see behind me these trellises supporting sweet peas. Let's go to some of the flowers themselves. And as we scroll through these beautiful pictures of sweet pea, and the peas themselves are not edible. These are grown just for cut flowers, and they're very fragrant. They're really fun to grow. We're running out a little time here. We're down to our last minute. So sweet peas come in a wide variety of colors. They're hybridized extensively. But we'll be back next week. And I want to thank our crew for all their hard work and help in putting on the show. And I just want to tell you what we're going to talk about next week, if I can get to it. Today, of course, was water. Next week, we're going to talk about insects. And we're going to talk and start our discussion of integrated pest management. We're going to talk about all the different groups of insects. But until then, I want to wish you happy gardening. Again, I'm sorry for any phone hiccups. We'll see you next week. Take care.